God alone is solitary truth. If God alone is solitary truth, then what about the manifest? God alone is solitary truth, and the rest, all that is manifest, is the celebration of that truth. What we see as the manifest world, the creation, is the celebration of truth. With this, Nanak removes all that is problem or ignorance about illusion or Maya. Nanak removes all criticisms leveled against illusion. The secret that even Shankar could not explain, Nanak unravels. What is the significance, difference between Nanak and others? It is erroneous to say that Nanak composed anything. I'll explain to you how does it happen. When you are constantly connected to your divine Wi-Fi or Alve Ghaib, then as Ghalib says, aate hain ye mazami khayal mein from gap se. Constantly you are connected to it. There is no other thought in your mind. No other realm is functioning. Words starts flowing. And you do not have to make any effort to see the rhyme, rhythm, tune or anything. Everything comes like a made from a different source. I'll give you an example. I was sitting down with one of the friends. He asked me how much sugar to put in my tea. I said, "Doc, give me a piece of paper and pen." But he could not find it. And by the time he found it, I said, "It's finished." And the words that happened, that is never written anywhere, is just in the memory. Zindagi ke samandar mein utha tha ek din leharon sa. Zindagi ka samandar. In the ocean of life, one day I rose like one of the myriad waves. Zindagi ke samandar mein utha tha ek din leharon sa. One day I rose in the ocean of life like one of the myriad waves. Mit aaj chala sagar ki gehrai mein. Today I have dissolved, disappeared in the vastness of the ocean. Mit aaj chala sagar ki gehrai mein. Today I have dissolved in the vastness, in the depth of the ocean. Reh gayi khamoshi si har mauj mein. Now there is only silence in every circumstance and situation. Reh gayi khamoshi si har mauj mein. Tufano ko jaise sahil mil gaya har reh guzar mein. It appears that every storm has found a silence. When a circumstance and situation comes, it comes like a hurricane, like a storm. Tufano ko jaise, every storm has found a shore. When the storm comes, the ocean becomes very wide. Its surface becomes so wide that you cannot see the shore. So it appears as if the storms, the turmoils have found a shore. It is only on the shore that the ship can anchor and take a rest. It was never written anywhere. This is the truth is being celebrated. So there is nothing that I had to do any effort to compose it. So Nanak did not write anything. He has experienced something in a state of meditation. He has a vision. He is expressing that vision in the form of words, in the form of songs. He is seeing that all around there is celebration. The birds are singing, the flowers are blossoming. That is their way of singing. The rain falling, the sun rising. Everything is happening in the universe. To Nanak, this is all celebration. This is a song. Everyone sings song in their own language, in their own way. But it is a celebration. It happened one day, Nanak happened to go somewhere and there was a prayer going on, the Hindu prayer. They were singing the praises, and that when you sing the praises of the particular deity, it is called aarti. You take a lighted lamp on a platter and you rotate, holding it in the two hands, you rotate it clockwise and anti-clockwise singing. That is known as the way of salutation, the way of respecting, that is known as aarti. When Nanak was told this, he simply looked at and he said, Gagan mai thal, the sky is the platter. The sky is the platter, and there the sun and the moon are like the two lamps. And the breeze that is blowing, that is bringing the fragrance of the flower. Because when you are doing the aarti, on a platter a lamp is lit and there is incense lit, so fragrance is there, the atmosphere is getting fragrant. So Nanak is seeing it the cosmic way, in a totally different way, because that is his vision. The sky is a big platter. On the platter, sun and moon are like two lamps lit. And the breeze that is blowing, that is bringing the fragrance. Then he says, what else can be the better aarti salutation than this? Gagan mein thal, ravchand deepak vane. And the star, the galaxy of the stars, he explains that becomes like a decoration. The breeze is blowing and bringing the fragrance. And that became the Sikh aarti. And now it is said that Nanak composed it. He did not compose it. A particular circumstance and situation came. You are connected to that divine Wi-Fi, and immediately the message started coming to you. For instance, each one of us have a cell phone. If your network is not working, you keep on calling, the call will not be registered, neither as the missed call, or in any way it will not be registered, because there is no internet connection. However, there is a secret. If you send a message, text message, that message will remain in escrow. It will not be delivered because there is no network. And as soon as the network is restored, that message, written or oral, will be delivered. What's the difference between the two? In the same way, every moment God sends you the message in the form of consciousness, in the form of many things. But your Wi-Fi is not working. You are not connected to the divine Wi-Fi. And because of that, the message is not being delivered to you. The moment you are able to establish that divine connection, internet connection, immediately you are able to decipher that message which is meant for you alone. The message that I sent you, and your Wi-Fi is not working, it will not be delivered to you. But the moment your Wi-Fi starts working, the message will be delivered to you. In the same way, God keeps on sending us the message. But our Wi-Fi is not working. Our system is not the internet system with God. Because the servers that we have in this cosmos, in this world, you have to subscribe to that server. If you have subscribed to AT&T, then if AT&T server is down, your Wi-Fi is down. Someone else may be connected to Airtel. Next one will be connected to some other network. There are many networks, but in case of God, there are no Hindu, Christian, Muslim network. His network is cosmic network. When the body, mind and intellect work in harmony with one another, the heart center is open, which is the communicative center, or sometimes you will find that there are the centers, those people who do not have the phone facilities, they can go to those centers and make their calls. So heart is that center through which you can easily get connected to the divine. And the moment that connection is established, partly you get the message. When it is established permanently, that every moment you are seeing there is celebration happening, Nanak is in that state. His connection is established permanently. There is no fluctuations. He have a high speed internet facility, Wi-Fi. Immediately the message is relayed to him and he start narrating to the people. And this is what it is happening. When he saw there is celebration all around, so in this particular composition he is saying that there is a celebration everywhere. The birds are celebrating, the flowers, the birds, the waterfall, the river, the breeze, the everyone is celebrating. And this celebration is the manifestation of truth that God is. So this is the one of the most important aspect to understand, and this is what had happened to Holy Prophet. Holy Prophet saw that celebration taking place, came and he explained, and the Sahibis wrote it down, and that became the Quran Pak, Quran Majid. But Nanak did not do this. It was composed by whoever, I do not know, but it is the celebration he is narrating, he is commenting. He is doing a live commentary on whatsoever is happening. You would have seen the cricket commentary, the lawn tennis commentary, or any of the commentaries that take place. A live something is happening. There is a commentator that is giving you a moment-to-moment description of all that is happening. Nanak is that divine commentator who is commenting all that is happening in the cosmos. That's why he has removed all criticisms leveled against Maya, the illusion that appears as to be. The flower blossoming appears as to be the flower is blossoming, but it is a reality in the sense that flower is blossoming. But behind that there is invisible hands that makes the flower blossom. And if your attention moves from the manifest to unmanifest, you are connected to the divine. The secret that even Shankar could not explain, Nanak unravels. Shankar is deep thinker and logician. He is known as the father of Indian Advait, non-dual, and has done tremendous work, compositions and everything. His whole emphasis was to explain the entire arrangement of the cosmos logically. This was the way of Shankar. Shankar wants to explain the cosmic arrangement scientifically and mathematically. But Nanak is a drunkard. He has drunk the divine wine to its heart content. And like a madman, he goes on singing, goes on dancing. Shankar knows consciousness and illusion, Maya. He knows Maya ceases to exist because that which is not is Maya. That which appears yet still ceases to exist. One moment it is there, next moment it is not. A flower blossoms of beauty manifest in a moment, and next moment it is not there. You get a vision of the beauty in your beloved, but next moment it is not there. This is illusion, Shankar says. But Nanak says in that moment it has the invisible hands has manifested that beauty. That beauty in the beloved, that beauty in the flower, that beauty in the song. Nanak's focus is on that. Shankar says that which appears yet still ceases to exist is Maya or illusion, and consciousness is that which remains invisible but exists. Maya is ever changing, just as the beauty of the flower keeps on changing from a small. If you see a flower blossoming in a slow motion, sometimes on the internet you see those kind of the images or videos where the flower is blossoming in bits and pieces. That's how the photography is done. The videography is done. The small the moments are captured together, put together, and then through the whatsoever the mechanism it is called, it is described together. It is videographed and is presented onto your screen. Shankar says Maya or the illusion is ever changing. It is dreamlike, and consciousness or Brahman that we call is ever eternal and ever existing truth. The question is not only before Shankar, instead before the entire non-dual system of Hindus. How does Maya come into existence? The illusion comes into existence. How does wave come into existence? The ocean is full of, it is a field where water is surrounded by its shores. Then there is a play of the air. Play of the air makes the waves to rise. If Maya does not exist, then there is no problem. When it is not a reality, then what is the problem? If it does not exist, why to worry about relinquishing it? It is childishness. How can one get entangled or lost in something that which is not? And when the wise talk about being aware and leave all that is illusion, what does it mean? This simply means the Maya exists. Maya means the manifested creation that appears to be manifested. Just as I mentioned to you, there is an emotions, the wave of emotions is arising in you. Your beloved appears in front of you. Suddenly you see beauty in that. But this beauty is momentary. Next moment another thought comes because that process is continuing. And when other thought comes, you do not see the beauty in this same thing. All of a sudden, it happens something. She is bringing a cup of tea. And all of a sudden, the teacup slips from her hand. The beauty is gone. And you know what you see at that time. Sometimes we do that. So beauty is momentary. But even if in that moment it is there and you get connected to that beauty, the giggle of the child, the blossoming of the flower, you, in that very moment you can get connected to the unknown and unknown. These days I was watching cricket. So in between an advertisement comes where the Indian Bollywood actors, they are appearing on the screen. Probably that is a part of the scene from a movie. Keep on joining the small moments. The big will come naturally. Chota milate jao, bada apne aap ban jayega. You keep on joining the small moments, small. Big will automatically come. What is the whole? Is some total of infinite moments of small moments. This is what photography is. The still pictures are taken, they are joined together and then converted into the video. That's why we see the movement. So the totality is the aggregate of some total and more than that. The ocean is some total of the waters of all the rivers plus something else. But if it does exist only then when we call about leaving it. Now I am going into a deeper state. When that state came in and the words flow, cherished it, recorded it in the memory and continued with a heart full of gratitude that a connection was established. May this connection be established permanently so that only his thoughts, the message, should keep on flowing from there. Every single syllable, every single word, every single one of my actions be reflective of that glory, that magnanimity, that awareness, that understanding that is cosmic should manifest through my actions, thoughts and words. Every single word should be able to inspire someone in one way or the other. Every single action should reflect that magnanimity, that the divine touch. When there is an expert who does something, there is an insignia of that. God's insignia should reflect through your words, through your actions, through your gestures, through everything that you do. If at all Maya exists, then it cannot be without God. If the flower blossoms in a slow motion, it cannot happen without the invisible hands behind that. Something has to be there to support it. Dream is there because you live in dreams. A film has been recorded. It was not fulfilled. It completes itself in the dream. Dream is there because you live in dreams. It is the unsolved riddle before the followers of non-dual movement or Vedanta, that is the end of knowing. If God is creating this illusion, then why do the wise, the awakened one have to go against? And where does it come from? If this illusion that appears to be existing but it does not exist is coming from consciousness of Brahman, and that alone is the real truth, then it can never be false. In this way, Shankar seems unable to solve this riddle. And Nanak has solved this riddle in a simple way. Shankar was a logician, a Sanskrit scholar, a very learned person. Nanak could not go even to the school when he was sent by his father to a Maulvi to learn. The Maulvi said to learn the alphabet Alif. Then he go on to the second, he said, tell me the meaning of Alif. Who asked the meaning of the word Alif? You know the alphabet is Alif, Be, Pe, Te, Se, Jim, Che, He, Khe. After Alif comes Be. But why do you stop at Alif? What is A? Unless you know A, how can you go to B? A is the beginning. What is beginning when something begins to come into existence? That's why we say A to Z. The Alpha and Omega in Greek language, the beginning and the end, an entire creation is encompassed between these two words, Alpha and Omega, A and Z. So when the person told, let's say the teacher said, learn the numbers, one, tell me what is one. If you cannot explain to me what is one, then why should I go forward? And if you have understood, the entire knowledge is based on understanding one, that which is. When you have understood that, then why to go to two or three or four or five? You have understood one. So the teacher found that Nanak was a crazy, a different kind of a student, who is not satisfied, who was not like any other students. So he brought back to his father and said that this child cannot learn anything, we know nothing to teach him. He asked certain questions of which we do not have answer. So that's how his education went. Then on his own he learned Arabic and Persian, so he was well versed in that. So his songs are that of rustic. Meera did not learn anything anywhere, but her songs are full of clarity, that she is seeing something that is happening. Nanak is seeing something. This is an aspect which evolves out of heart. When heart is crystal clear, it becomes the mirror. It reflects all that is happening deep within. Within is a manifestation of a replica of all that happens in the cosmos. And this is what Nanak is explaining in this particular sutra. Shankar was unable to solve this riddle, but Nanak had solved the riddle. That which logic cannot solve, love can solve. For Nanak, this Maya, these hues of many colors spread all around, is nothing but celebration of the unknown and unknowable. He does not call it Maya. He calls it the celebration of that which is. God is truth. If God is truth, then the manifested world, manifested cosmos, that the other school of thought calls it as illusion. Nanak says this is the celebration of that which is. The truth is solitary, it cannot change. It is an X, but around which the wheel can keep on moving and changing its position and distance. So this manifested world is nothing else but the celebration of that which is. He is just sitting down, smiling. Axel is there doing nothing. Around that, everything begins to move. The wheel moves, covers a distance. You move from one place to another. If you are traveling along the highway or the interstate, then you can stop somewhere, have a cup of tea, relax yourself and start the journey again. Nanak says this is what is constantly happening in the universe. All these hue of many colors, fragrance that you see all around, is nothing but the celebration of the unknown and unknowable. These infinite sounds, ragas, raginis, all are happening at his door. And this is the beauty of this particular sutra. Maya is the celebration of the inner bliss. What we call as illusion is the celebration of the inner bliss. There is an inner joy in the bud. It is full of beauty and the fragrance. It cannot contain its beauty, so it blossoms in the form of flower. The flower has, the bud has blossomed, has become a flower. Flower spreads its beauty and fragrance as long as it is. And the moment its life comes to an end, it starts withering away. Whenever someone is blissful within, then many invisible things begin to happen. Just feel yourself when you are happy, what you do. When you are full of bliss within, what you do, you express it in different ways. You scream, you dance, you smile. You do many things. Just imagine what you do when you are full of bliss. So the similar thing is happening to God, but he is ever blissful. There is not even a single moment when he is not blissful. So if you are blissful every moment, what would be the manifestation? What would you create around yourself? You are dancing. You are so blissful that you fix this, you fix that, you bring the beauty in this corner, in that corner, you go in the kitchen, you do all kind of imaginable and unimaginable things, you go on doing it. Just imagine what is your situation when you are very happy. When you are happy that your beloved is coming, you are trying to fix up everything, the room of the person, the blanket, this and the minute things you are looking into, some things you try to do yourself, that maybe the other person whom you have delegated this responsibility may not do, may not. So you want to make sure that everything is spick and span, There is no shortcoming in it, because there is an eternal joy that my beloved is coming today. So how it is not happening? So Nanak says, gives a totally a different dimension of that which Vedanta calls it as illusion. He says there is so much of joy within that which is. The truth is exuberant of the inner joy or bliss. It expresses it in many forms and colors. Whenever someone is blissful within, then many invisible things happen. Just imagine yourself. These butterflies, colors of leaves, flowers, and so many colors are all expression of his celebration. He is blossoming in so many colors. When you go dancing and frisking from one corner to another, fixing this, cleaning that, and so, what is this? You are not tired at that. There is a different kind of energy that you have entered into. Different level, different layer of energy you have entered into. Otherwise, by nature, you are lazy. You cannot even get up to take a cup of tea. If you can get clear your stool even on the bed, that is good enough. You are so lazy. But now, because something has happened within, there is a joy, there is a bliss overflowing. You are dancing and frisking, feather-like, and you are fixing this and that. And so how can that be illusion? It is an expression of inner joy or bliss. He is blossoming in so many colors. All around is the extension of that totality. Maya, illusion that appears to be but it is not, and consciousness are not separate. Maya is the dance, the celebration, and the song of that which is. When you are dancing, you are frisking, you are doing this and that, that is not an ordinary work. This is the dance of celebration. This is the celebration of inner bliss. This is the song of the beauty, of the bliss that is happening within, a totally a different dimension. Shankar is Brahman's dry and insipid. When Shankar says the consciousness, that which is the ever-expanding consciousness, Aham Brahmasmi, that is dry and insipid, because his Brahman does not have a celebration of joy, and he does not consider Maya or the illusion as the celebration. It is like a principle of mathematics. It is like an infinite zero. How can you love such a Brahman or consciousness which is mathematical? But Nanak's Brahman is celebration. His consciousness is not a hypothesis of a mathematician. Instead, it is an expression of a poet. Expression of a poet and the manifestation of the inner beauty of the lover. That which is logician or a philosopher cannot solve in lovers. That which lovers can solve very easily. How can you measure mathematically how much joy is there? But you can express that inner joy in many forms. This is the way of Nanak. He is expressing the inner joy. And he says all that appears to be, it is short-lived, it is ephemeral, is nothing else but the exuberance, is the overflow of the inner joy of that which is. Keep this in mind, for Nanak, Maya is the celebration of God and Brahman. That's why I said, God is the solitary truth, and the manifest that we see around is the celebration of that solitary truth. This is the reason Nanak did not ask his disciples to leave the world and the affairs. All the awakened ones do not tell you to leave the world, leave the family and everything and retire in the solitary caves. Yes, sometimes it may be necessary. You can make your house a solitary cave at times. Nanak continued to remain into the mood throughout his life. He will go on the pilgrimages. He will come back, pick up his plow and start continuing his farming. And leaving the world, where would you go? You will leave the family, your job and everything, go to the mountain or the solitary caves or somewhere else. Where would you find? The first sentence I spoke to my wife is that the truth was that sentence. Beauty, that place is beautiful. But this is the experience of my life. If you can keep your instrument attuned, you can feel the feeblest of vibrations anywhere in any part of the world. You are sick. You go to a sanatorium. You go to a hospital. You go to a nursing home. There everybody is there to take care of you, give you the medicine in time, give you a specific diet. Dietitian comes and prepares a dietary chart for you, and the food is given to you according to that, because everything is organized in that way. You cannot just hide and take a pack of fried chicken and eat it. No, that is restricted to you. But the moment you come out of the sanatorium, you start doing things in your own way, and then you lament that in sanatorium I was feeling very good, but here at home I am not, because there was a discipline, an inner discipline, that the food was given to you at times, but here now you are eating at whatever time you want to eat, middle of the night. You are working until late in the night, 12 o'clock, you take a big platter of food and you eat. You can create your own inner discipline, that I have to eat food at a particular time. And if at that time you miss your meals and you go at an odd time to eat, you will not die if you skip the meal one day. You already have stored fat in you that the body can consume if that be necessary. Then where would you go leaving the world? Nanak says to his disciple to seek the eternal while you are part of the world. In anything that you see, see the invisible hands. When you go and meet a customer, when you meet your employee or employer, see in him the invisible hands of God. When he speaks, it is he who speaks. Maybe his body, mind and intellect is not as sharp as yours. The connection, his internet connection is feeble, so the voice is coming distorted. That's the only difference. If you have a high-speed internet, you get very clear image. And if you have a smart TV that works on IPTV, then at times your system will go on streaming. So the difference is between you, who has been given by the coincidence and by grace of God the opportunity to have such association, but the other person does not have. So your effort has to be that you have become a bridge between that person and the one whose association you have. So through that bridge you communicate. Maybe the words, it takes little longer time to connect. The streaming takes a little longer time because the signal from the source is very weak. When the signal is weak, the streaming, the image, the picture comes, the continuity is lost. Such is the case with that person. But you are in an association where there is a constant continuity. You be the bridge with that person, but you are seeing the invisible hands. You don't need to go anywhere. Nanak says to his disciples, seek the eternal in the world. When all is his creation, then your search has to begin from where you are, his creation itself. Nanak cautions, never get lost in the play. Your attention has to be on the player. And who is the player? The surati, the awareness, the witnessing. Do not get lost in the dance. Be aware of the one whose dance surrounds you. But if we start singing, if we cook a beautiful or tasty dish, people start praising, you think that it is done by you. And you start appreciating those accolades. No, those accolades does not belong to you. When the electricity is working through your electric stove efficiently, it is the electric current and the stove has simply been the instrument to manifest that. A beautiful incident comes in the life of Winston Churchill. After the Second World War was over, England won the war. It was Harold Wilson who was his deputy that time. He said, he addressed to Winston Churchill, and in his commemoration he said, it was you because of who the England won the Second World War. Immediately, I would put it as an aware Winston said, Harold, you are mistaken. The lion's force was possessed by the countrymen. The lion's force was possessed by the countrymen. I simply had the luck to give a roar. The force was with the divine. My instrument has been made in such a way that one of his quality could manifest. One of his quality has manifested at this moment. I am thankful that it is because of his grace that the instrument did not break down in the process when his qualities were being manifested. That is my only credit. And that too comes because of the divine grace. That the instrument, my body, did not fall, my words did not falter. There was no break, or I had to search for a particular word to fit it in that space. Oh, the connection breakdown, the voice did not come, or the melody or something. No, everything remained intact. The presentation was good because everything was flowing in properly. That is my credit. All the rest, the credit goes on, and I am a witness to it, that everything is flowing normally. The words are flowing, the sentences are being formed, the grammar, the punctuation, everything is normal. I am witnessing it. So I am not getting lost in the dance. Be aware of the one whose dance surrounds you. Look at the trees, listen to the songs of the birds, but do not get lost that you forget the unmanifest behind this creation. When you see the beauty, appreciate that. It is the dance of the creator. The creation is the dance of the creator. The blossoming of the flower is the dance of that unmanifest energy that is at play behind the blossoming of the flower. Keep on searching the unmanifest in the manifest. The moment you go on searching the unmanifest in manifest, you have got the secret. You have got the secret.